see a doctor.
I know. Let's take her to the races.
The races?
Yes, my mother's box at Ascot.
You'll ask her first, of course.
Of course.
No, we better surprise her.
Let's clear off. First thing in the morning, we'll go and get her a lady's gown.
But, sir, it is early in the morning.
What better time to work than early in the morning? Pickering, where does one go for a lady's gown?
A Willis.
You know that.
Common knowledge.
Is it? Well, I detest those gowns that are all flowery with a weed here and a weed there. Something simple and elegant was called for. Perhaps with a sash. Quite right.
You know, you've all been working much too hard. The strain is starting to show. I don't care what Mr. Higgins says, Eliza. Put down your book.
My son Henry.
girl to the embassy ball, and he had to try her out.
I beg your pardon.
Well, you know, the embassy ball.
Well, yes, I know the ball, but what the...
Didn't I mention that?
No, you did not.
It's quite simple, really. One night I was going to the opera at Covent Garden to see my favorite opera, Aida. Well, as I was leaving, by the way, they didn't do Aida that night. They did Gotterdammerung instead. Never heard of Gotterdammerung. What a racket thing. This tenor chap threw the entire thing.
What about the girl?
Oh, yes. Well, as I was leaving, I met Henry, who in turn met Miss Doolittle, who now lives with Henry.
Lives with Henry?
Oh, heavens no, Mrs. Higgins. She's a flower girl. He picked her up off the curbstone.
Flower girl?
Pickering, he says to me, in 6 months' time, I can make this girl a duchess. Nonsense, I said. He came right back with, yes, I can. So I said, okay, I'll make you a bet that you can. And I did. And he is.
The horses are leaving the paddock.
I really must fetch her now.
Oh, what could? Am I to understand that Henry is bringing a flower girl to Aberth?
That's it. That's it. Exactly, Mrs. Higgins. Oh, jolly good. Jolly good, Mrs. Higgins.
Charles, you'd better stay close to the car. I may be leaving abruptly.
Here with you.
Mrs. Higgins, is this your celebrated
sorry to say my celebrated son has no manners. He may be the life and soul of the Royal Society soirees, but he's rather trying on more commonplace occasions. Ah, Colonel Pickering, you're just in time for tea.
I thank you, Mrs. Higgins. May I present Miss Eliza Doolittle?
My dear Miss Doolittle, how kind of you to let me come. And delighted, my dear.
How do you do, Charm?
Lord and Lady Boxington, Miss Doolittle.
How do you do?
How do you do?
I'm pretty honest with you.
How do you do?
How do you do?
The first race was very exciting, Miss Doolittle. I'm so sorry you missed it.
Which rain do you see?
The rain in Spain stays mainly in the plain. But in Hartford, Hereford, and Hampshire, hurricanes hardly ever happen.
Hello?
What on earth are you laughing at, young man? I bet I got it right.
Smashing.
I hope we don't have any unseasonably cold weather. It brings on so much influenza, and our whole family is susceptible to it.
My aunt died of influenza, so they said. But it's my belief they've done her in.
Done her in?
Yes, Lord love you. Why should a woman die of influenza when she come through diphtheria right the year before? Oh, Lewis that she was. Everybody thought she was dead, except my father. He kept ladling gin down her throat. Then she came to so sudden, she bit the bowl off the spoon.
Dear me!
Now, what cold woman with that sort of strength when her hat to die of influenza? And what's become of her new straw hat that should have come to me? Somebody pinched it. And what I say is them as pinched it, done her in.
Done her in, did you say?
That's the new small talk. To do one in means to kill them.
But surely you don't think your aunt was killed?
Do I not? Them she lived with would have killed her for a hatpin, let alone a hat.
But it couldn't have been right for your father to pour spirits down her throat like that. It couldn't have killed her.
Oh, not her. Gin was mother's milk to her. Anyway, he's pulled so much down his own throat, he knows the good of it.
Did you say that he drank?
Drank? My word, something chronic. Here, what are you sniggering at?
Oh, nothing. The new small talk. You're doing so well.
If I was doing it proper, what was you laughing at? Have I said something I oughtn't?
Oh, not at all, my dear.
Well, that's a mercy anyhow. What
Perhaps
I
there's
said?
Still time to place a bet on the second race. Come, my dear.
Okay, not.
If I had the bet on number 7, I would be so happy if you would take it. I would enjoy the race ever so much more.
When she told about her father,
way you've driven the girl for the past 6 weeks is beyond all bounds of you. Higgins, for God's sake, stop pacing around and settle someplace. Have some port.
It'll quiet your nerves.
I'm not nervous. Where is it?
On the desk.
The car is here, sir.
Ah, very good. Are you helping Eliza?
Yes, sir.
Good.
Helping her, indeed. I'll bet the damn gown doesn't fit. I told you about those French designers. We shouldn't have gone to a good English shop where we knew everyone was on our side. Here, have a little port.
No, thank you.
It'll quieten your nerves.
No, thank you.
Are you so sure that Eliza will keep everything you've drummed into her over the past 6 months?
We shall see.
But what if she doesn't?
Then I lose my bet.
You know what I can't stand about you, Higgins? It's your confounded complacency. At a time like this, with so much at stake, it's utterly indecent that you don't need a little port. And what of the girl? You act as if she doesn't matter at all.
Oh, rubbish, Pickering. Of course she matters. What are you going to be doing all these months? What could matter more than to change one human being into another human being by creating a new speech form? Why, it's filling up the deepest gulf that separates class from class and soul from soul. She matters immensely.
Queen of Transylvania is here this evening, and I am indispensable to her at these international parties. I know everyone in Europe. I speak 36 languages. Enough, Professor. You must introduce me to this glorious creature you escort this evening. She fascinates everyone. Not since Mrs. Langtree came to London has anyone created such a stir at a function. I was there the last month. She was an ass bump, and what she did there was most unorthodox. In fact, I would not have believed some of the things that I heard when I went on there. Now, I have to wonder.
His Excellency, Dr. Themistocles Stefano.
The so-called Greek diplomat. He pretends that he does not speak English, but he does not deceive me. He is the son of a Yorkshire watchmaker. He speaks English so villainously that he dare not utter a word of it without betraying his origins. I help him to pretend, but I make him pay through the nose. I make them all pay. I look forward to meeting your lady.
I say, Higgins!
Where is Eliza?
Upstairs, last minute adjustment.
I say we call it off. Let's gather the girl and leave immediately.
Oh, but Henry, do you think it is nice to stay?
Stay?
Why not?
Miss Eliza Doolittle.
Oh, Professor, you must introduce me.
Transylvania, and Prince Igor.
strong from every pore. He boiled his way around the floor. Every trick he could play, he used to strip a mask away. And at last the dance was done, he glowed as if he knew he'd won. With a voice too eager and a smile too broad, he announced to the hostess that she was a fraud!
No!
Her English is too good, he said, which clearly indicates that she is foreign. Her instructors are instructed in their native language, English would be foreign. And although she may have studied with an expert dialectician and grammarian, bed and sleep it off. Have a little cry, say your prayers, and make you feel comfortable.
I heard your prayers. Thank God it's all over.
Well, don't you thank God it's all over? Now you're free and can do as you like.
What am I fit for? What have you left me fit for? Where am I to go? What am I to do? What has become of me?
That's what's troubling you, isn't it? I wouldn't bother about that if I were you. I'm sure you'll have very little trouble settling yourself someplace or other. Although I hadn't quite realized you were going. You might marry, you know. Old men are not confirmed old bachelors like me and the Colonel. Most men are the marrying sort. Poor devils. And you're not bad looking. At times, it's quite a pleasure to look at you. Not now, of course. You'd be crying and look like the very devil. But when you're all right and quite yourself, you're what I should call attractive. So, clear off to bed, have a good night's rest, and then get up and look at yourself in the glass. You won't feel so cheap. I dare say my mother could find a chap or two who might do very nicely.
We were above that in Covent Garden.
What do you mean?
I sold flowers. I didn't sell myself.
Oh, tosh, Eliza. Don't insult human relations by dragging all that cant about buying and selling into it. Be married, fellow, if you don't want to.
What else am I to do?
Oh, lots of things. Well, what about the old idea of the flower shop? Pickering can set you up in one. He's got lots of money. You'll have to pay for all those clogs you've been wearing, and that, with the hire of the jewelry, would make a very large hole in £200. I must clear off to bed. I'm devilishly sleepy. By the way, I was looking for something. What was it?
Your slippers.
Ah, yes, of course. You shied them at me.
Before you go, sir, Do my clothes belong to me or to Colonel Pickering?
What the devil use would they be to Pickering? Why need you start bothering about that in the middle of the night?
I want to know what I can take away with me. I don't want to be accused of stealing.
Stealing? You shouldn't have said that, Eliza. That shows a want of feeling.
I'm sorry. I know I'm a common, ignorant girl, but in my station, I have to be careful. There can't be any feelings between the like of you and the like of me. Help us, please. Will you tell me what is mine and what isn't?
Well, you can take the whole damn house full if you want to. Will that satisfy you? Except the jewels. They're hired.
Stop. Would you take these to your room with you and keep them safe? I don't want to run the risk of their being missing.
Hand them over. No, if these belong to me instead of the jeweler, I'd ram them down your ungrateful throat.
This ring isn't the jeweler's. It's the one you bought me in Brighton. I don't want it now. Don't hit me!
Hit you? Presumptuous creature, how dare you accuse me of such a thing? It is you who have hit me. You wounded me to the heart.
I'm glad I've got a bit of my own back anyhow.
You have caused me to lose my temper. A thing which has rarely ever happened to me before. I prefer to say nothing more about it tonight. I'm going to bed.
You'll have to leave your own note for Mrs. Pierce about the coffee, or it won't be done by me.
Damn Mrs. Pierce, and damn the coffee, and damn you, and damn my own folly in having lavished my hard-earned knowledge and the treasure of my regard and intimacy on a heartless gutter snipe.
You'll be the one that's done to the world. take the Mr. Doolittle if you'd like. But
thank you, Mr. Doolittle.
Father.
You see, Eric, he has no mercy on me. Setting around to spy on me in my misery, it'd be all flesh and blood. We're all miserable, all right? You can tell him that straight away.
What are you talking about, and what are you all dressed up for?
As if you didn't know. You go back and tell that Wimple Street devil what he's done to me.
What has he done to you?
Ruined my life, he has. Destroyed me happiness. Tied me up and cast me into middle-class morality. Don't you defend him. Was it him or was it not him what, look to that all-American blighter. Wallace Bidwell's giving away £5 million moral reform societies and tell them the most original moralist in all of England was Alfred P. Doolittle, called it just now.
Sounds like one of his jokes.
Well, you may call it a joke, but you put the lid on me straight away. Your bloke dying left me £4,000.
Come on, Alfie, we've got to be at the church soon.
Church?
Yes, church, the most unkind cut of all. Well, what do you think I'll dress up like a ruddy undertaker for? Your stepmother wants to marry me, not that I'm respectable she wants to.
I guess so. I'm happy about it. Why don't you just give the money back?
Oh, that's a tragedy, Eliza. It's easier to say, Chuck, I haven't got the nerve. We intimidate. That's what we are. We're all intimidated. Bought up. That's what I am. That's what your precious professor has done to me.
Not my precious professor.
Oh, sent you away, has he? First, he shoves me in a middle-class morality. Then he chucks you out for me to support you. All part of his plan. You don't force him, Eliza. Don't you come running home to me. Don't you take tuppence from me. You stand on your own feet. You're fighting out.
What time is the wedding, Father?
By the way, you want to come and see me get turned off this morning, St. George's, Hanover Square, 10 o'clock. You're welcome to come, but...
No, thank you, Dad. Good luck, Dad.
How much time I got left, Harry?
I'm getting married in the morning.
and her clothes?
I told you, sir, she took them all with her.
Pickering?
What?
Well, what? Here's a confounded thing. Eliza's bolted.
Bolted?
Yes, bolted. And Mrs. Pierce let her go without telling me a word about it.
Well, I'm dashed.
I can't understand it. I got tea this morning instead of coffee. I can't find anything. I don't know what appointments I've got.
Eliza would know.
Well, of course she'd know, but damn it, she's gone.
Higgins, did you bully her after I went to bed last night?
Quite the other way around. She threw the slippers at me. I never gave her the slightest provocation. The slippers came bang at my head before I even uttered a word. She used the most awful language. I was shocked. I'm dashed. I can't understand it. She gave her every possible consideration. She said so herself.
I'm dashed.
For God's sake, Pickering, stop being dashed and do something.
But what?
Call the police. What are you there for, in heaven's name?
But, Mr. Higgins, you can't give Eliza's name to the police like she was a thief or a lost umbrella.
Well, why not? I want to find her. The girl belongs to me. I paid £5 for her.
Quite right. Scotland Yard, please. Mrs. Pierce, can I have some coffee?
Yes, sir.
Good morning, young chap. Colonel Hugh Pickering here, 27A Wimpole Street. I'd like to report a missing person. Anything you can do to help find her will be frightfully appreciated. I'm not without influence there, and I'll make certain that your superiors are... Yes. Eliza Doolittle. I should say about 27. Around 5'1". Odd.
Brown.
Brown. Hair. Well, really, no color at all. Not in the script.
Brown. Brown. Brown!
In the morning. No. 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 No relation at all. Let's just say a good friend. Now see here, young man, I don't like the tenor of that question. What the girl does here is our affair. Your affair is to get her back here so she can continue doing it.
Well, what in all of heaven can have prompted her to go after such a triumph at the boat? Irritating, vacillating, calculating, agitating.